love and unity to all of God's children. Should be a great event, and the whole day should be spent in full remembrance of those who lived and died for the oneness of our people. So let us all begin. We know that love can win. Let it out your hold it in.
Welcome to the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. celebration. We are having folks come in right now. Welcome, everyone. We have an amazing program for you today, and I'm going to hand it over to my co-MC.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Yuwanda Egans, and welcome to the 17th annual Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Health Fair. Thank you so much for being here to honor Dr. King's legacy and to learn together about health and wellness. Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated has partnered with local businesses to showcase talent in the region, and some will include door prizes donated by these local businesses. We have 10 prizes that will be given out randomly throughout the presentation today. I'll give background on the business and then announce the winner. I would now like to introduce Yuriana Garcia-Tellez, Diversity Outreach and Engagement Coordinator for the City of Bellevue, who will be my partner in hostessing today. Welcome, Yuriana.
Thank you, Wanda. It's an honor to be here today, celebrating the Dr. Martin Luther King 17th annual anniversary celebration. This is huge. This is a partnership that the City of Bellevue has had an honor to participate with Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. And today is really special. I think that today, with what is happening in our communities, more than ever, we really need hope. And that's just what, you know, Dr. King's legacy left behind for us. And so we join together today to celebrate Dr. King, as well as look at how we can make this a day on, not off. And so just to start off with today, I would like to acknowledge the land that we currently stand on. So on behalf of the City of Bellevue, we acknowledge the land we are on as ancestral homes of the Coast Salish people. the traditional home of all tribes and bands within the Duwamish and Snoqualmie Indian tribe. We take an opportunity to honor and express our deepest respect for the original caretakers of this land, people that are still here, continuing to honor their heritage. So thank you everyone for being here with us. We have a full program today with lots of performances, resources around healthcare and COVID. It's really addressing some of the biggest issues that we have in our community today. And hopefully you are able to enjoy with us today, as well as this program is being recorded, and so you will be able to share and come back to as many times as you need to. Typically, we do this in person in a mall where we have rows of resources, tables of resources where you can walk around and peruse. Today, our program looks a little different. We have a mix of health resources, speakers, and performances. So we're adapting and being flexible to what we will show today. Just a little bit of housekeeping. Feel free to interact with us and participate in the chat. This is, you know, really an opportunity for us to build community. Be respectful, of course, of everyone. And I'd like to especially thank our attendees who are here today on this Monday, our panelists who will be speaking today on the different health resources that they have brought us today. And I'd also like to thank our council members who are joining us today. So Mayor Lynn Robinson, Deputy Mayor Neuenhouse, Council members Barksdale, Zahn, Lee, and Stokes. They'll all be joining us today at some point. And so for now, I'd like to pass over the mic to Mayor Lynn Robinson, who will say a few words, followed by Council member Barksdale.
Okay. Thank you, Yuriana. Good morning, everybody. It's an honor to be here. I'm Mayor Lynn Robinson, and I'm behalf of the city of Bellevue, I welcome you. I want to thank Delta Sigma Theta for their continued partnership in supporting our community and making events like this possible each year. Nuwanda, it's nice to see you virtually. I get to see you ladies every year at Crossroads Mall, so it's nice that we can continue this tradition, and thank you for your support. Every year we gather to celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in the city of Bellevue. And this year, obviously, we're gathering virtually, but we're also more connected than ever in sharing, in our shared navigation of the many crises of this year. Dr. King was a trailblazer, a teacher, and an advocate who was fighting for the equitable rights of all when he was brutally shot and killed. And today he continues to be an inspiration and a guide. And we celebrate how far our country and our city has come since he died, with the realization of how far we have yet to go. In his closing words of his Nobel Peace Prize address in 1964, Dr. King reminded the world of the following: in spite of tensions and uncertainties of this period, something profoundly meaningful is taking place. Old systems of exploitation and oppression are passing away, and out of the womb of a frail world, new systems of justice and equality are being born. I thank the city and staff for their equity work, and I celebrate you all for your participation and for being a part of this event today. We still have a lot to do, but we can and will do it together. And with that, I'd like to introduce to you fellow council member, Jeremy Barksdale.
Thank you, Mayor. And thanks to everyone for being here. The MLK Day celebration and health fair is a big event for the city, but this year it takes on special significance because we know that communities of color are disproportionately impacted by COVID-19. The past year has been especially traumatic for communities of color as we witnessed the racial injustices seen across our country. King County Public Health declared racism a public health crisis, acknowledging the toll it takes on our health and well-being. Today's event is one way we can support each other, stand up for the values of racial equity and access to healthcare, and help advance Dr. King's legacy of building welcoming, supportive, and equitable communities. At the city, we see MLK Day as a day on, not a day off, because it's a chance to focus on and further the community values shared by Dr. King. Dr. King, among other civil rights leaders, including members of our Black Greek-led organizations like our co-sponsor today, Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, invested their blood, sweat, and tears to advance racial justice in our country. It's a day on because we must keep fighting for equality and equity, a need that is more evident now than it has been since the civil rights movement. For many people of color, this is not a day off. It's not a day off from work. It's not a day off from compounding impacts of systemic racism, and it's not a day off from racial injustice. Thank you to staff and Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated for organizing today's events, and to all of you for taking the time to share this day on in recognition of Dr. King and his legacy. I encourage you to please check out the February edition of It's Your City to learn more about Dr. King's legacy and upcoming events in celebration of Black History Month. I'll hand it back over to you, Rihanna. Thank you.
Thank you so much, both Mayor Lynn Robinson and Councilmember Barksdale. It's an honor to have you today, and I really hope that, you know, we are able to live through some of that messaging that we just heard from both the mayor and Councilmember Barksdale. We have an exciting program today and more speakers to come. But for now, we would like to welcome and open it up with our first performance of today from Jamie Williams. Jamie is a youth spoken artist from Richmond, California. After winning a compliment death match in 2017 National Poetry Slam, he became the first person to be dubbed as the nicest poet in the USA. Jamie is also an accomplished actor. Please welcome Jamie Williams as he shares some of his poetry with us today.
Hi, good morning, everybody. Good morning. My name is Jamie Williams. I'm an educator, actor, rapper, and poet from Richmond, California. And I have the pleasure today to start our day with some lovely poetry and some lovely music. A lot of the work that I do is, it talks about the Black community. So I feel like it's very relevant, especially in today as we celebrate Dr. King. I would like to start my performance with a quote by Maya Angelou. This quote I saw very early on in my career, and it really influenced a lot of the work I do. So I hope that you all are inspired by this quote as well. And it goes like this. This is from Maya Angelou. We, the Black people, the most displaced, the poorest, the most maligned and scourged, we take the glorious task of reclaiming the soul and saving the honor of the country. We, the most hated, must take hate into our own hands and by the miracle of love, turn loathing into love. We, the most feared and apprehensive, must take fear and by love, change it into hope. We who die daily in large and small ways must take the demon death and turn it into life. So that quote was by Maya Angelou. I read that really early on. And it actually inspired this next piece that I got coming up for you. So I really hope that you enjoy it as we remember Dr. King today. And it goes like this. I started my day with some Black girl magic. No name, Jamila Woods, fantastic. Erykah Badu and Lauryn Hill too. A little Jill Scott on the side to get me through, cause I'm in need of positivity and the truth today. I hear their words, it's sweeter than Kool-Aid. I listen what they say, put it on replay. I listen what they say, keep it on replay. I started my day with some Black girl magic. No name, Jamila Woods, fantastic. Erykah Badu and Lauryn Hill too. A little Jill Scott on the side to get me through. I'm in need of positivity and the truth today. I hear their words, it's sweeter than Kool-Aid. I listen what they say, put it on replay. I listen what they say, keep it on replay. Hello world, how you doing? Glad to have your attention. Did you know that Black women always been magicians? And if you didn't, then I really gotta say that you tripping. Who else has been known to always handle their business, handle the children, handle the world, do it all? When I need my spirits up, I know who to call. Hand in hand, we make a stand. Together, we fall. But I'm going to be here by your side today and tomorrow. So when times get rough and you down on your luck, I'm going to lift you up, dust you off, and show you some love. See, I'm just trying to repay everything that you give. I know mothers who are mothers, but they ain't got kids. I got women I call auntie who ain't my kin. I give everything I got to protect my friends. We gonna build this fortress brick by brick. Together we work better, cause you know how it is. You the voice in my throat. Give me heat when I'm cold. Turn the house to a home. What's a man with no soul? To all the women that I love, here's a thank you note. All the women that I love, a thank you note. Cause a Shaniqua will teach ya. Best Santoya done told ya. Pamela knows it all. Yeah, my mom is a soldier. She taught me how to survive and keep my head above water and how to check on myself when I fill out an order. Because I started my day with some black girl magic. No name, Jamila Woods, fantastic. Erica Badu and Lauryn Hill too. A little Jill Scott on the side to get me through. Cause I'm in need of positivity and the truth today. I hear their words is sweeter than Kool-Aid. I listen what they say, put it on replay. I listen what they say, keep it on replay. I started my day sitting down in the kitchen, 4 feet away from my mama as she swiftly prepares dinner with a certain level of practice precision. And I begin to smell it. The heat waves creeping out of the oven are always accompanied by an aroma. It smells like the sweetest treat that can only be conceived in the South. The wines that are only allowed to melt the pink taste buds inside of your mouth on Sunday. It smells like women made miracles. Dashed with tablespoons of black girl magic. It smells like overt optimism in the face of poverty. And as always, I see her chocolate hands lift in pots and pans. Mama's chocolate hands always seasoning the chicken. Mama's chocolate hands always chopping the onion. Mama's chocolate hands always opening cans of corns, beans, and yams today. I wondered how many other little chocolate boys have watched their mama as I have mine. And then the muscles in my abdomen start contracting and I started asking for something that I cannot give it, love, like my mother's. And honestly, it took me 2 decades to realize that the kitchen has always been a symbol for life, and I have always been watching my mama. Mama's chocolate hands always lifting up all 6 of her kids. Mama's chocolate hands always chopping down barriers. Mama's chocolate hands always making sure that we were well seasoned with knowledge and education. Mama's chocolate hands always opening massive cans of I dare you or any idiot foolish enough to mess with one of her babies. And some days, y'all, I want to drop my responsibilities and run home so I can give her a hug. See her moving about in the kitchen so I can finally say, Mama, do you need a hand? As a matter of fact, you can lie down tonight and I'll cook dinner. I'll use unconditional love as the secret spice, the same taste that I've been feasting on for 24 years straight will always be attached to my memories because of you. Mama, it's time I baked you something beautiful. Thank you, y'all. Thank you for allowing me to start with that piece. I have one more piece and one more quote for you. This other quote that I have, it is also by Maya Angelou, but in her book, The Heart of a Woman, she's talking about Dr. King. And I felt like that was really, really topical to today. She talks about seeing him perform. And this is what she says about Dr. King. He was here, our own man, black, intelligent, and fearless. He was going to be born to us in a moment. He would stand up behind the pulpit, full grown, and justify the years of sacrifice and the days of humiliation. He was the best we had, the brightest and most beautiful. Maybe today will be the day we find ourselves free. And when I first read that quote, it got me thinking about back when I was still in college, in my sophomore year after English 1002, this overprivileged girl from Danville dared to stretch her paper-thin lips and tell me that my city was nothing more than a black bird on its deathbed. She said she never stops in Richmond. She just drives past on her way to school because Richmond is too dangerous. And until this day, There's an ocean of anger inside of my chest, wishing that I looked her dead in the eyes and said that my city is not a buckshot loaded into the barrel of a shotgun. Richmond is the city of pride and purpose that you do not get to deem worthless. My city is not a blackbird on its deathbed about to croak. I like to call it the black smoke, dancing on top of the bonfire as if there is no tomorrow. And yes, my city knows sorrow. It has mastered the art of holding death and progress in the same breath. It heard the thunderclap of bullets raining on Cutting Boulevard, rinsed the blood off of its fingertips, and never even had a moment to mourn, because in the morning, it had to become the sun pulling apart the night sky like blinds to reveal a brand new day. Richmond is a place of praise, y'all. It's the loudest hallelujah that should leap from your lips. It's the alarm clock buzzing in your brain, letting you know it is time to wake up. Richmond is made up of melanin and stardust, and blood and bones. So I call it home to the future's biggest protest, because my city looks a lot like a revolutionary at rest. It is a pulsing heart the size of a black power fist, doused in the flames of being forgotten. My city knows how to be forgotten, knows how to tuck itself inside of itself. But ain't that all a hood is anyway? Two sides of the same coin, two sets in the same city, two gangs gunning at each other like there isn't a common enemy, like there isn't a multitude of institutions constructed to carry black bodies into cages or coffins. So whenever I walk into these public schools, I refuse to see a violent crime rate 138% higher than the national average. I choose to see a body of black and brown students with pebbles of hope thrown so far down their well-shaped hearts that it is hard to walk on the asphalt without hearing calling your name. Until this day, I wish I told that girl from Danville that Richmond looks a lot like the moon, constantly going through cycles of its own rebirth. Better yet, it is a phoenix rising from its own ashes, ready to reclaim itself, ready to rename itself. It's something that never has to die on the tongue of those who refuses to see its infinite beauty. Say it with me, Richmond. Thank you so much, everybody, for allowing me to perform. As we move on, I just want to say I was really honored to be here. I'm going to leave my website in the chat if anybody wants to connect, because I would love to continue this work in honor of Dr. King. And I hope that you all have a great rest of your day.
Thank you so much, Jamie, for that absolutely moving, moving presentation that really helps us to remember and to honor Black history. And you've truly, truly blessed us, truly blessed us. Thank you so much for sharing your talent with us. And now we're actually going to move on to some door prizes. And so I want to reiterate, as I had said a little earlier when we started today, that the Bellevue Alumni Chapter for Delta Sigma Theta has partnered with some great local businesses, and they have donated several prizes for us today. And so our first vendor is Buna Buna Coffee, who's owned by Ephraim Fasaha. And they are actually located off of 3rd in Renton. They have several media features with King 5, Como, Q13, and they have a door prize of 2 12-ounce bags of roasted coffee. And we actually have our first winner. Again, for those of you not on with us when we first started, these are randomly selected from those of you participating today. And our first winner is Ola Oakes. Ola Oakes, O-A-K-E-S. Ola, we will be contacting you via the information that you registered with for this particular event. And if you connected with us and did not register through Eventbrite, we will put that link in the chat so that you can register and we'll have your information. And now we have a second, we have our next door prize with another community partner. And the vendor is Creative Lou. And this is a art design company who's owned by Damon Brown. And information there on the slide for you to see. Several media features here as well. He's been featured on King 5, Voyage LA, Lifestyle Seattle. And so we have a door prize from this business as well, which we're really excited about. 5 11x14 prints from Creative Lou. And the winner is Sandra Early. Sandra Early is our winner for the second door prize. And again, if you would please register if you haven't already so that we know how to contact you. And if you register through Eventbrite, we have your information and we'll be reaching out to you. So again, thank you so much to our two community business partners for their donations. Now we are gonna move on to our first speaker of the day, and I am really excited to introduce her to you. Dr. Kim Holland is going to be speaking to us about mindfulness. She is a retired family practice physician. She co-leads a mindfulness group for women with chronic illness. The group meets on the fourth Saturdays, and if you would be interested in participating in this group, please contact her at the email address that will be posted in the chat. And now I'd like to welcome Dr. Kim Holland.
Thank you so much. Jamie, we honor you. We honor you and everyone who is in your generation that is out there doing the work. Thank you so much for that. Here we are on Zoom. I actually have lipstick on. I cannot believe it. And the mascara is running from tears of happiness. So thank you so much. If you have gotten on this today, then you can get on the internet. And when you're on the internet, you can Google mindfulness. I just put up that one slide so that we could know what mindfulness is together, but I am not going to talk about mindfulness today. We're going to do some mindfulness practices that you can take out and practice at any moment during the day. So I'm just going to go ahead and start by asking each one of you, I know that I can't see you, but you can see me. And just like those trees behind me that wave and communicate to each other through the air and through their roots. If you would just say your name into the room where you're at and call yourself into this Zoom room right now. Let's take a deep breath and call yourself into the room. Kim Iona Holland. And then, as Jamie said, if you have a Black mama or a Black girl magic that you could call into the room with you, it could be someone who is currently here on the planet or someone who came before, or it could be someone who isn't born yet that you're just baking, and call her name and say her name. And I will call in Rachel Virginia Holland, my mother. With my next breath, we're going to do a centering practice. And then following that, once we've centered and grounded in our purpose and who we are, then we will center and ground in who we are, all of us together, with a second practice. So, if you're seated in a chair, please notice your sit muscles and the support that's present of gravity. It's always there. To find the center of the body, take a thumb and place it over your belly button with the fingers just gently pointing downward towards the floor. If you're laying down, same thing, or if you're standing, If you're able to stand and you're standing, please keep your feet about shoulder width apart. And with your next breath, breathe into that space in the center of the body, right below your thumb. Just noticing the air as it goes in to soft baby's belly and out. God, please help me lead this exercise with compassion and awareness of this moment without judgment, without striving in this body. With the next breath in and out, there's no need in mindfulness to work at breathing. The body will breathe itself. Just notice where the air is going in through the nose or the mouth and where you feel it the most in the body. If that's not working, take a breath in and a breath out. Again, in and out. And one more time, breathing at your own rhythm and pace, in and out. For those of you who are not sheltering at home, wherever you are, if you're putting your hand on the car door to go to work, or on the doorknob to provide service, thank you to all of you who are bringing us food, you first responders, Amazon delivery. These are all caretakers. This is a stealth meditation that can be done whenever you put your hand on a doorknob. Breathing in. I know I'm breathing in. I'm breathing out. I know I'm breathing out. With the next breath, notice the length of the body. The feet on the floor, supported by gravity, always supported by the earth. Breathing into soft belly, extend that breath from the feet all the way to the top of the head, because that is our dignity. It's the strength on which we stand. Savor the dignity. Maybe stretching a little bit forward. We don't have to shrink for anyone. With the next breath, just savor our depth. Standing or sitting or laying down, notice the back. The muscles of the back, sensations of the clothing on the back, or maybe even the support of the chair, leaning back. We can lean into the ancestors who came before us. I call in Malcolm. I lean back. But our depth is not just the past, people. It's also what's in front of us. So with the next breath, experience the space between the back and the front of the body. The invitation is to breathe into the lungs and feel the heart space, feeling the front of the body. Our depth is our sense of purpose, what we live into. This body comes with an expiration date. No one of us is going to be here forever, and yet we will be here forever. So with the next breath, breathe into what's in front of us. that thing, that person, that idea, that thing for which we live. I call in Cadence and Corinne, my great-grandchildren and their great-grandchildren. This is a day that is now. We savor each other now, and we savor the future. Grateful for the past and grateful for the future. Just savoring that space of our depth. And with the next breath, just unfurl the lungs just a little bit and open up the chest wall, feeling our width. Not striving, just finding a comfortable space between the left side and the right side. So often we close in. That's our boundary when we need protection. We close in a little bit. But also the invitation is to open up, not striving, but just let those shoulder muscles, that backbone open up and breathe into the space that we get to take up because we were born. Relaxing. And if it feels comfortable, let the arms out to encompass not just our own space, but the space that we share here on planet Earth in this moment. And then bringing the arms back down. In gratitude and togetherness. Breathing in our dignity and length, our depth and purpose, and our width of those guardrails that we have so that we know right action, and also our connectedness. In this moment, savoring the time we have together. If the eyes are closed, the invitation is to open them and come back into the room. Because now, our appointment's just about over. You're about to leave my virtual office. If you remember any of that tool and you practice it over time, small moments, many times a day, that mindfulness can lower blood pressure. 5 mindful bites of eating can last throughout the meal and allow us to eat to fuel our body and fuel our future rather than fueling our anxiety and numbing our feelings. Mindful breaths are useful in chronic pain and arthritis. And as I promised you, now that we're just about done, I'll ask you to put your hand up in a fist and hold those fingers as tight as you can together, just feeling and allowing that hand to protect you. Aware of what it feels like in the body to hold the hand in a fist. Tell your thumb, don't let go. Breathing into the hand and noticing the tension. Allowing the other hand to slowly come up and rest what happens to the fist when it is supported. Just noticing and allowing the presence of loving kindness . Feel free to use that face your fears meditation, noticing what happens in the body with the fist and what happens to the fist when it is gently, lovingly, and compassionately supported. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Holland, I feel really relaxed actually now from your mindfulness exercise. So thank you so much for reminding us that it's important to take those times during the day, and that it's not only just for general well-being, but really appreciating the fact that there's physical aspects of well-being that come from mindfulness. So thank you so, so much for joining us today and sharing those exercises with us today. And now we're going to move to our next speaker of the day. And I would like to introduce to you Kevin Henry with Sound Mental Health. He is the Diversity Inclusion Coordinator at Sound Mental Health. He is also a consultant, a trainer, a writer, a radio host. And so we now welcome Mr. Kevin Henry.
Thank you very much. And I hope everybody can hear me okay. Give me a signal if you can't, of some kind. I'm like so relaxed now. It's like I lost my concentration. I was sitting here thinking about the fact that this was such a great way to start things off, because, you know, let's face it, 2020 has been a very turbulent, upsetting, distressing year. And whatever we can do to promote healing and self-care, understanding, so that 2021 can be a year of opportunity, an opportunity to learn from what happened in the previous year and bring some unity to the country. Because right now, I recently wrote a blog, and I was trying to think of a clever title. So I called it Healing for a Nation in Pain. Because no matter what your political affiliation or what your background is, I think if you just turn on the TV or you're just aware of what's going on outside your front door, it's a lot of people in pain. You know, I see pain, I see anger. And like I said, I think this is a great opportunity to work on getting our mental health together. And sometimes what that involves is having hard conversations, getting out of our comfort zone, and really starting to build those bridges of understanding between people that are maybe different from yourself. A little bit about Sound Mental Health. We've been around since 1966. We have about 600 therapists, counselors, clinicians, peer counselors. We have several locations, one of which is in Bellevue. We have other locations in Capitol Hill, Auburn, Lake City, Tukwila, Belltown, Northgate. And we work primarily with underserved populations, marginalized populations, very racially diverse populations. We work with people who have a mental health diagnosis of some kind. So we're talking about depression, substance abuse, PTSD, bipolar, schizophrenia, people with various disabilities. So we have programs that address different levels of severity when it comes to that client base. So in some cases, we're working with people who are very functional, they go to work, but maybe they have episodes of depression. all the way to the other end of the spectrum with somebody who maybe is bipolar who just got out of prison after 5 years. So we're working to empower, engage, and assist them in various ways. So with that comes the necessity for our clinicians and our team members to really understand the diverse populations that they're working with, because we have a lot of people. I mean, we have a fair amount of diversity at Sound, and I think about 30% of our staff members are BIPOC, but then 70 to 80% of our clients are BIPOC. So one of the things we've been concentrating on is the topic of racialized trauma, meaning that a lot of people from different backgrounds carry with them in their mind, their spirit, and their body, a lot of trauma from the past, which can be generational, it can be incidents that they've had with police officers, it can be different types of microaggressions that they deal with. And so what can happen very often is unknowingly our clinicians and our team members can trigger an intensification of that type of trauma, which can affect our client's life. So we focus on at Sound in bringing in guest speakers, having workshops, having seminars. We also have a series of sharing circles for our team members, where team members can come together and process what's going on with the Black Lives Matter movement or the racism that's playing out on the streets of America. We have it split into three different sharing circles. We have a general one that everybody can come to. We have a White Allies sharing circle, and we have an African American sharing circle. We also have an internal chemical dependency group that meets to discuss what are some of the things that influence chemical dependency and drug addiction. So we're really trying to cover just about anything that has to do with mental health and how we can assist our clients. The other thing that we're working on as well is creating partnerships with outside organizations. So I would say that, and I put my email in the chat, but it's kevin.henry@sound.health. We're working with the NAACP to put on health fairs and events that can address the health disparities when it comes to African Americans, as well as people of color and BIPOC communities. We also have a partnership with the Police Accountability Group and Seattle Police, and also a little bit with Bellevue Police. We're starting to make some inroads there, in that what we're trying to do is work with police officers so that they can get a better understanding of the mental issues that can affect our clients. And the hope there is that some incidents that might play out to some type of tragedy can actually be de-escalated. So again, it's about bringing people together to have discussions. So with all the distress and all the pain and anger and suffering that's been going on in 2020, topped off by COVID, of course, we also look at Sound as a place where people can come as a client, as a partner, as a nonprofit, so that we can come together to not only promote understanding within ourselves and with our own professional communities, but also it enables us to better serve our clients. And all of the nonprofits, as well as the city of Bellevue, for instance, is we have a community to serve. So I would encourage you to contact me and we can brainstorm, maybe we can collaborate on some things, anything that has to do with mental health issues. We have 600 clinicians, team members, therapists that are all available to dive in and assist the community in understanding these issues that are so impactful to our communities as well as ourselves. So once again, it's kevin.henry@sound.health. And thank you for thank you very much for having me today.
Thank you, Kevin. We thank you for the resources that you shared, and thank you, Dr. Kim Holland, as well for the very relaxing meditation. As mentioned earlier, this is this is being recorded. And so hopefully, you know, if you did sign up through the Eventbrite, you'll receive a recording of the event and we'll be able to play it as many times as possible to follow some of those recommendations. I especially enjoy the fact that Dr. Kim Holland mentioned that it does have real impacts on our pressure, as well as just the, you know, reducing some of the health barriers that we often see within communities of color. And so thank you so much. We are moving forward onto our next portion of the event. We would like to highlight some of the organizations in the East Side that are doing amazing work. One of these organizations is the Parent Alliance for Black Scholars. Their mission is to educate, advocate, and empower and mobilize families in the East Side for Black scholars, specifically in the Bellevue School District. And so you will see on the screen their contact information, so their website. Feel free to check them out. And then the next exciting performer that we have is Naomi Washita. Naomi Washita is a African, Kenyan American Afrofolk singer. She brings music today from Kenya. And so please enjoy this amazing artist who brings a contribution and an offering to give hope and life to everyone around us. So we'll go ahead and start that now.
Hello, my name is Naomi Washita and I'm an Afrofolk singer-songwriter. It is such an honor to be with you here today in celebration of Martin Luther King and the health fair. And I am coming to you pre-recorded from Kenya, where I have been for the last year, and just because of the pandemic. And I would love to share the next 20 minutes with you just to create this expansive and breathable space, because I know it's been really, really difficult for so many of us in so many different ways. And we've faced so many challenges. And my hope is to create just an expansive space that we can rest, we can breathe, we can just be empowered, be inspired, be reminded to hold on to hope, even when it feels like everything is falling apart and can't tell up from down, or so that is really my hope for the next few minutes, is just to offer you encouragement and to just give you something that puts a little light in your heart and a little step, a little pep in your step. And so that's what I hope to do. Anyway, I'll start out with this song. This is a song I wrote a while ago, a long time ago. And when life gets really hard, this is a song I always pull out, because it's this reminder that being alive in and of itself is a privilege, it's a gift, and it is worth celebrating, even when it feels like you're in a dark tunnel and you can't see your way out. That it truly is. Just be grateful that you're here, that you're present, that you're alive, that you have food, that you have family or friends or people that you can, you know, lean on or count on. And so this is I'm Alive.
It's an honor and a privilege when I can say I'm alive. Beyond the breathing, beyond the waking, I am alive. And when I shut down to shield my heart, 'cause I've been hurt too many times, and I don't wanna go through another heartbreak, still I know I am alive. It's the pain, it's the hurt, it's the love, the disappointment, I know I'm alive. Yeah, yeah, yeah. reach out my hand in quiet desperation, because I want to live.
Feel like we are about to combust in so many different ways. And at the end, my hope is that when we go through these really, really difficult moments, that we get to ask ourselves the questions of who do we want to be? What kind of people do we want to become? And move towards whatever it is that we want to be. And to me, those the tenets of humanity are about kindness and love and empathy and mercy and grace that we extend to one another to help each other, because, you know, life is always complicated and it's not always a bed of roses. And so this is called Up in Flames.
Sometimes I feel like I don't have what it takes to keep moving on. I look to my left, I look to my right, and all I see, all I see, all I see, faces down, fear in our hearts, people just keep throwing stones. Faces down, fear in our hearts, people just keep throwing stones. Oh, 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 am I the only one who thinks we're gonna go up in flames? Oh, 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 am I the only one who thinks we're gonna go up in flames? Yeah, 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 flames. Bad news keeps happening everywhere, everywhere I look. And I'm losing faith. Faces down, fear in our hearts, we just keep throwing stones. Faces down, fear in our hearts, we just keep throwing stones. Oh, 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 am I the only one who thinks we're gonna go up in flames? Oh, thank you.
Called I Am Because You Are comes from Zulu word called Ubuntu. And in the most simple understanding, at least for me, the way I understand Ubuntu is this idea that we all reflect each other, we're all reflecting one another. And as such, that it means that we tend to be kinder to one another when we know that, you know, that we're all an ecosystem, we're all coexisting, and that we all need one another. And, you know, we can't live in our own little islands and think that life is going to be okay. And so I hope with this that we just remember that, you know, that we're in this together, and we are an ecosystem that needs each other in order to thrive and and flourish. So this is I Am Because You Are.
We are because you are because.
Amazing. That was our performer Naomi Washita from all the way from Kenya right now. She was there and was stuck because of the pandemic, and so it's just been really an honor to listen to her voice today, as well as just, you know, the message that it gives us. So please, you know, round of applause for Naomi, you know, wherever you're at. And so thank you so much, Naomi. Now we're moving on to the next part of our presentation. And we do have council members who have joined us and also will be saying a few words. And so I'll hand the mic over to Deputy Mayor Nguyen House, who will be followed by Councilmember Lee. And then we'll also have Councilmember Zahn say a few words as well. Thank you so much for being here. And I'll hand the mic off to you, Deputy Mayor.
Thank you. Thank you for that introduction. And good afternoon, everybody. Pleasure to be here today. And again, please give a virtual round of applause there for Naomi Washita. What an incredible voice, and what a great way to continue the celebration. And if her goal, as she said, was to put a pep in our step, she certainly did that for me. So again, I'm Jared Nguyen House, Deputy Mayor for the City of Bellevue. And it's just so great to be here at the annual Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Celebration and Health Fair this year, held virtually. I'm sure most of us would prefer to be in person, but it's you know, great that we could still get together virtually. And I also want to thank our community partners, the alumni chapter of the Delta Sigma Theta sorority, for making this celebration and health fair happen for many years. This past year, as been previously noted, it's been a difficult one for all of us, which makes today even more necessary for us to be in community and to be able to share a special day with each other. In Bellevue, we are committed to Dr. King's idea of a beloved community based on justice, equal opportunity, embracing differences, and seeking areas of commonality. In order for communities to thrive, all the individuals and families who make up those communities must thrive. This was the vision of Dr. King and is the primary purpose of today's health fair. Over 20 providers are here today with the common goal to help to offer helpful resources and inspire a healthy and thriving community. Our council vision statement, adopted in 2014, reflects our commitment to equity and inclusion by including these words: Bellevue welcomes the world, our diversity is our strength. Dr. King believed that barriers could be overcome with hard work and open minds, with embracing a welcoming spirit and seeing the strength of diversity as we strive to do just that here in Bellevue. So again, it's my pleasure to be here today. I'm glad so many of us could join virtually. Enjoy the celebration as we live Dr. King's message, not only for today, but every day. I'll now turn it over to my colleague, Councilmember Conrad Lee. Thanks. Thanks again.
Good morning. Thank you, Deputy Mayor Newhouse. I'm Conrad Lee, council member. I'm here today to celebrate with all of you Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day, and to remind us of his messages of freedom, justice, and love for all. As a longtime council member, I'm proud that the city of Bellevue shares these values. We are committed to embracing equality and inclusion to make our city more supportive for everyone. This is a tall order, a work in progress. I'm old enough to have seen Dr. King's struggle and his ultimate sacrifice to get us to where we are. And however, it's still a long way to go. COVID-19 pandemic reminds us and tells the story. We must continue every day to carry on Dr. King's legacy and dream. In watching the performances today and seeing the sharing of health resources and information, I can see that Dr. King's influence and legacy continues. It's inspiring to see that our community carrying on Dr. King's legacy and dream. I hope you all have a chance today to reflect on the examples set by Dr. King and enjoy being able to connect with others. In the spirit of community support and unity, it takes all of us working together. So enjoy the rest of the program and look for more events and opportunities city hosts, like the Black History Month to be celebrated in February. You know, to celebrate and promote freedom, equality, and love for all. Thank you.
Thank you, Council Member. Council Member Janison, would you like to say a few words?
Yes, thank you. So thank you so much for being here. I'm Janison. I'm one of your Bellevue Council members. And you know, I have to say that this is one of the most meaningful events in Bellevue because we've been doing this for a long time. It's both a celebration of Martin Luther King and a health fair. And I think that even especially more important this year, you know, I think about Martin Luther King's words, "Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about the things that matter." And the other one, which is, "What are you doing for others?" So here, this is about a day of service, a celebration, taking care of ourselves and each other and our health, and that shared hope and vision that living while Black is the same as everyone else, and that equity matters. And this year, I think Martin Luther King Day is even more meaningful because, as we've seen last year, racism is a public health crisis. And also that with COVID, we've seen the health disparities associated with the color of people's skin, which is just wrong. So, and also just a week and a half ago, right, that what we also saw was the things that we thought would never happen. And yet what I kept thinking about is that, you know, really what we need to do is make sure that we're listening to our Black community about their experiences and really understand deeply about what they're going through in terms of the challenges. Because the other phrase is that true peace is not merely the absence of tension, it is the presence of justice. And lastly, that we are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. So as I show up here with you today, I think about the fact that it's both a celebration and a health fair, and also that we're honoring and continuing the work of Dr. Martin Luther King towards a world, a country, a city of peace and justice for all. So thank you so much for being here. And the artists are just amazing. Naomi, your voice is just so incredible. The poem from Jamie all of the people that are here. And I think that's also refreshing to our souls as we do this really tough work together. So thank you for being here and enjoy the rest of the program. Thank you.
Thank you so much to Deputy Mayor Newhouse, Council Member Lee, and Council Member Zahn for your really thoughtful comments. And I'd also like to add my thank you to Naomi, particularly for that last song. And I just really want to note that word Ubuntu. I am because you are. I am because you are. And the way that she creatively wrote a song about how empowering that concept is, it's just really, really powerful and moved me a lot. So I just wanted to make sure that we didn't have that concept, that we made sure that we focused on that concept as well in her music. So now we are going to move on to another set of speakers. We next have actually a video from Bloodworks Northwest. And Landon Bennett is the donor resource representative from Bloodworks. And in past years, he would have had a donation station on site with us with our on site health fair. But because we had to be virtual this year, the city of Bellevue and Bellevue Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta is actually going to partner with Bloodworks Northwest for the MLK Blood Drive from January 15th to January 20th. Information will be put in the chat so that you can find that location. And now we will see that video.
Hi, everyone. My name is Landon Bennett, and I work for Bloodworks Northwest. Bloodworks Northwest is our area's primary local blood bank. We provide about 95% of the blood to over 80 hospitals in the Puget Sound area, including Overlake and Harborview and Evergreen. We rely on about 1,000 donors a day to provide a stable blood supply to those hospitals. And they need a lot of blood on hand because a lot of people end up needing blood in our area. A lot of cancer patients wind up needing transfusions, or women going through labor, or victims of car accidents. There's a long list of reasons people need blood products, and there's a long list of people that we need to donate blood each and every day to make sure that those hospitals that we support have a stable blood supply for their patients. As you might imagine, this year has looked a lot different for us than it does than most years have, as I'd imagine your year has looked a lot different than any other year in your life. Normally, we would have a blood mobile parked outside in the parking lot while we would all be on site and seeing each other face to face without masks on at this fair. And that's not the case. This fair has moved to a virtual fair where things have had to be modified. And just as we're doing a virtual health fair this year, we are also doing a virtual blood drive for the Martin Luther King Health Fair. Last year, about 17 people donated at the Blood Mobile, which went on to help 17 patients at local hospitals. We want to maintain that generosity and let you guys know what opportunities are out there for you to still donate, given that we can't donate in that blood mobile in the parking lot this year. So what we've decided to do is a virtual drive. The virtual drive started on January 15th and runs through January 29th. And it allows us to just keep track of everybody who donates on behalf of the Bellevue Martin Luther King Jr. Health Fair. So the way you can take part in this blood drive is by going to our website, bloodworksnw.org, and finding a place to donate. We have pop-up donor centers, which are kind of scattered around the region. The Mariners have hosted one at T-Mobile Park. The Bellevue Arts Museum hosts one every couple of months. Churches and community centers and just a lot of groups in the area have stepped up to host week-long or two-week-long or three-week-long temporary blood drives. We also have our permanent brick-and-mortar donor centers. The closest one to Bellevue is our Bellevue Donor Center. It's on 132nd Avenue, and they are open 7 days a week from 8 to 6. So regardless of where you donate, and it can be, again, at any of our locations from from Bellingham all the way down to Eugene. If you donate between January 15th and January 29th and mention the Bellevue Martin Luther King Jr. Health Fair when you go in to donate, you will be counted towards our blood drive. The generosity that the people at this fair showed last year made a huge impact on the patients at our hospitals. And we want to find a way to kind of come together as a group in a way that maintains social distancing and keeps you healthy, but also make sure that the hospitals in our area have an adequate and stable blood supply as long as this pandemic lasts. So if you'd like to take part, again, you can go to bloodworksnw.org and find a location near you. And be sure to mention the Bellevue Martin Luther King Jr. Health Fair. And thank you so much for taking the time to listen to this announcement. And thank you again for your generosity and support of patients at local hospitals. Have a good day.
And so it was wonderful to get that additional information about the virtual blood drive. And we do hope that many of you will consider participating in that. And so now we will have another video. And this video is about wearing masks. As we all know, we are still in the midst of a global pandemic. This is a video from Veronica Hicks Redmond. She's a physician's assistant. And she's also a graduate of the University of Washington School of Medicine. She has been on the front lines with COVID from the very beginning, and her video will talk some about mask wearing. And now for Veronica's video.
I graduated from the University of Washington School of Medicine Medics program in 2005. Today, we're going to talk about choosing the best mask to help protect you and others from the spread of COVID-19. We're also going to talk about how to wear a mask properly and how to care for your mask properly. The Center of Disease Control recommends that all people wear a mask in public settings. For example, if you're on mass transportation, you're at an event, you're at a gathering, or you're around people that are not in your immediate household, CDC recommends that you wear a mask. Do not put a mask on anyone that is under the age of 2. Do not put a mask on anyone that is having trouble breathing or anyone that requires assistance removing a mask. Okay? So during this pandemic, we wear masks to help protect ourselves and others from getting and spreading COVID-19. So the CDC recommends that we wear cotton masks. The lay public wears cotton masks, and it's 2-ply or greater. And so one of the things that they say is if you get a mask that's 100% cotton and you hold it up to the light, if you can see the individual fibers in that mask, then it's most likely not effective. And so today here, I have several masks that I want to share with you to show you what's good and what's not good, okay? So this here is a disposable mask. You can buy this from the grocery store. A lot of people are buying these online. So this here would be a good choice for a mask. This is a cotton mask that a friend of mine made. This is 2-ply. It has a slot here where you can buy a filter to place inside. This too is also a good choice. This is a cotton mask. It's 2-ply as well. You can see here when I say it's 2-ply, there's 2 layers here. Ordinarily, I wouldn't touch the outside of the mask. I wouldn't even touch the inside of the mask. I'm just demonstrating, showing you what to look for when you purchase a mask. This is another mask that was made by someone
It has two layers as well. And so this is also a good choice. So gaiters, a lot of people are wearing these. These are called gaiters. The CDC has found that these are not effective. So do not purchase these, okay? If this is all you have, then it's okay to wear. We just ask that when you put it on, that you double it down so you have a double layer over your nose and mouth. So do not purchase this unless this is your only choice of protection with a mask, okay? And also bandanas. The CDC does not recommend the use of bandanas either for masks. It's not that effective as well. So you wanna stay away from gaiters and bandanas unless it's the only choice that you have, okay? And then N95s. So a lot of people are trying to get N95s. And so they recommend that you do not purchase N95s. N95s are considered critical supplies for healthcare workers and first responders. These masks actually have to be fitted. And there's a test that you go through to make sure that it fits you properly. And so once again, these are for healthcare workers and first responders. When you buy N95s off the internet, number one, you haven't been fitted for it. And so it's most likely not effective. The other thing that they're finding is that a lot of the N95s that they're selling, they have valves on them. And the CDC says that the valves are one way. And so your respiratory droplets, your breath is expelled out of the mask, out of the valve. And so you're not protecting the people around you. So if you have COVID-19 and you have a mask like that on, you're spreading it. When you're breathing in your mask, your particles, your respiratory particles are actually coming out of that mask. And I just want to show you what that mask looks like. So hopefully you can see that there. So stay away from these type of masks, whether they're regular masks or whether they're N95s with these valves on them.
Okay, we want to say thank you to Veronica for giving us an overview of the appropriate type of mask to wear. Not only that, but how to handle the masks and why some masks are not actually good to wear. So we want to thank her for that. And so now we're actually going to do two more door prizes. And so first, we will start with our essential candle. So I'll wait for the slide to come up so you can see their information. This is a candle company owned by Damon Brown. There we go. And as you see, there is an information there if you want to contact him. He's been featured in several places, Seattle Green Book, YouTube commercial ad, and the prize that he's donated to us, and we're so grateful again for the partnership, is 3 8x5 ounce candles. And so we actually have a winner, and the winner is Malver Hayes, M-A-L-V-E-R Hayes is our winner. And again, we will contact you. You need to have registered through Eventbrite for us to have your contact information. If you did not register through Eventbrite, we will put the link in the chat so that you can register and we can get your prize to you. And so we have another partner we're going to feature who's partnered with us. And again, I want to stress these are all Black-owned businesses. And so it's really important to Bellevue Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta that we support our local businesses and in particular Black businesses. So even if you don't win a prize, please support these businesses. So our next business is Alpha's Louisiana Seasoning and Spices Deli. And they actually are located off Meeker in Kent, Washington, owned by Neil Robinson. And you can see there's contact information here. They've also been featured a variety of different places, King 5, Seattle Times, While Black in Seattle blog, several different places. And we have two gift cards at $50 for a value of $100, which is the prize from Alpha's. And our winner for that prize is Christine Young. So congratulations to Melva and Christine. So now that we've given away some door prizes, which are always a lot of fun, we are going to actually get up and get moving. So next we have Dance for Fitness with Tony Bailey. And so Tony is going to take us through some dance fitness moves. She is also a Zumba dance instructor and has been for 12 years. She is proud to have turned married 3 years to her Edwin. She has 3 daughters, 2 sons, and we are so grateful to have her here today to get up and get that blood pumping and get us moving with some fitness moves. So with that, we have her live here today, and take it away, Tony.
Okay. Hi, everybody. Let me get this going here. Good afternoon. First, I want to thank the city of Bellevue. I want to thank the alumni chapter of Delta Sigma Theta for always showing me love. And shout out to all my friends that are Deltas. And a shout out to my godmom, Thelma Payne. I know she's watching. So I'm gonna be muted. You guys just move for a little 15 minutes. I know you're all relaxed now. We have some good relaxation. Now we're gonna move a little bit. If it's something you can't do, just march in place to the music, take it easy, and get some water and a towel. 15 minutes doesn't sound a lot, but it does, it helps to move. We need to move, being all secluded in the house, can't get to the gyms, all that kind of stuff. So hopefully this will help you. You guys ready? Let me get the music going. Work hard, play harder all day long. All the continents get you can see me 3D overseas. If you know me, then you know where to find me. Off in the Bahamas with a bad one behind me. Now live it up, live it up, live it up. Baby, pick it up, pick it up, pick it up. And we gone.
We have all the ladies, but it's hard to see these ladies when your middle name's Equator. All around the globe, matter of fact, see you later. They're great, we're greater, we're world dominators, and we're also some smooth operators, and we gone. We'll be right back.
want to do. Can we slow it down? I just want to.
Thank you, Tony. Who had fun? I hope you all.
We got time for one more?
Yeah, sure. Does everybody have time? One more. Let's do this.
Hey, feeling good. Like I should. When in Durga, walk around the neighborhood. Feeling blessed, never stressed. Got that sunshine on my Sunday best. Yeah. Hey, every day can be a better day despite the challenge. All you gotta do is leave it better than you found it. It's gonna get difficult to stand, but hold your balance. I just say whatever, cause there is no way around it. Everyone falls down sometimes. But you just gotta know it'll all be fine. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. Hey, feeling good, like I should. When in Durga, walk around the neighborhood. Feeling blessed, never stressed. Got that sunshine on my Sunday best. Some days you wake up and nothing works, you feel surrounded. Gotta give your feet some gravity to get you grounded. Keep good things inside your ears just like the waves and sound it. And just say whatever, cause there is no way you're grounded. Everyone falls down sometimes, but you just gotta know it'll all be fine. It's okay. It's okay, it's okay. Hey, feeling good, like I should. When in Durga, walk around the neighborhood. Feeling blessed, never stressed. Got that sunshine on my Sunday best. Hey, feeling good, like I should. When in Durga, walk around the neighborhood.
Wow.
Woo! 15, 30 minutes a day is all you need. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tony. I hope everyone had a chance to get up and move around. It really is an honor to have Tony here and you know, just be in your presence. And so I want to thank you again for being here and following this along. You will probably see that, you know, we do have our our features in the Zoom call, which include the chat. So feel free to interact with all of us as we are dancing along. So again, thank you, Tony. I'd like to take this moment to highlight another great organization that is transforming the East Side, East King County. This is East Side for All, a place where racial, economic, and social justice is made possible for communities of color. The focus is racial equity, immigrant and refugee justice, and an inclusive economy. And you see the information on the screen. So if you want to learn more, visit their website or contact them or follow them on social media. And so I'm out of breath. I hope all of you are out of breath with me. Next, we have a very special guest from King County Public Health, who will be sharing some words with us. I want to thank especially King County for all the amazing work that they've been doing to respond to this COVID-19 pandemic. And as mentioned earlier from one of the council members, also just recently, the declaration of racism as a public health issue. And this is huge for our communities. And so now I will hand it over to our guest speaker, Matias Valenzuela, who is joining us here virtually. Matias, you have the floor.
Great. Thank you for having me. That's a tough act to follow. And I'm also a little bit out of breath, but that's, I loved it. Thanks, Tony. And also thanks to the city of Bellevue. And also enjoyed hearing from council members and the mayor. So thanks everybody for having me here. It's an honor to be here with you today. We are in a county, King County, that is named, and many of you know, after Dr. Martin Luther King. But this has not always been the case. Of course, these were tribal lands, but also with colonization and the expansion of the United States for many decades, our county was named after Rufus King. Rufus King, it was a different king, was a founding father of the United States who helped frame the Constitution. He was a senator, a diplomat. He ran and successfully for vice president and for president in the early 19th century. Also, he was a slave owner. And that's who King County was named after for many decades. Today, we all sit or stand or are in Martin Luther King Jr. County. I think this change of our namesake took a long time, and it was the work of many at the state and local level. But during this time, I think it's extremely important to acknowledge our Black leaders, including our former council member at King County, Larry Gossett, who made this change possible. I've been and worked for King County for about 20 years now, mainly in public health. And I find myself honored to work in the area of racial equity and health in a county now named after Dr. Martin Luther King. And we have been doing in our region, not just county, but also many of the cities, including the city of Bellevue and others, are really leading this work nationally. But I think we have so much further to go. Dr. King said, when we look at modern man, we have to face the fact that modern man suffers from a kind of poverty of the spirit, which stands in glaring contrast with a scientific and technological abundance. We've learned to fly the air as birds. We've learned to swim the seas as fish. Yet we haven't learned to walk the earth as brothers and sisters. I look at our region and I am amazed at the wealth, the advancement, the industries here. We have some of the most powerful and wealthy people and companies in the world, yet we have some of the largest inequities in our country. In our county, like nationally, race and place matter. Our white populations are among the wealthiest and healthiest in the nation, if not the world, yet many of our communities of color have similar outcomes to communities of color in other parts of the country. So in fact, our inequities and gaps are in many ways greater. Did you know that men face an 18-year life expectancy gap across county of 68 compared to 86 years based on where you live? residents and census tracts of places like Mercer Island, and even actually in Bellevue, it's very high as well, have some of the highest life expectancy, while those in places like Auburn and other areas of Southeast King County have the lowest. These are geographic differences that are racialized, since this reflects the racial patterns, or also could also be called our current racial segregation that exists in our region. We see these outcomes by race and place play out in all conditions and diseases. Of course, a city like Bellevue also has these significant differences by race and place, as those in central Bellevue are more racially diverse or more likely to be in poverty. This is local, regional, and national challenge for all of us. Dr. King also said, we are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. Right now, we are all thinking about the pandemic and COVID-19, and nothing highlights our interrelatedness plus the systemic inequities more than the current pandemic. With COVID-19, Black, Latinx, Pacific Islander communities in our county and Indigenous communities are 2 to 5 times more likely to be infected than white individuals. That's 2 to 5 times in our Martin Luther King Jr. County. And this is not due to individual choice and behaviors under one's control. These are deep-rooted inequities in our structures and systems that determine who has access to the social determinants of health, good jobs, housing, education, healthy foods. For COVID, who is an essential worker? Who is working in grocery stores, transit, factories, warehouses? Who lives in multi-generational households? These are our BIPOC communities, our communities of color. And white individuals and families are much more likely to have the luxury to be able to telecommute and stay safe. The start of this year has been so challenging on top of a very challenging 2020, but our communities of color, especially our Black and Indigenous communities, are resilient. I won't get into the details of recent violence and storming of institutions and the mob in the other Washington, which one of the council members already referenced, where we saw the ugliness of white supremacy. Folks of color were not surprised either by the acts themselves or by the lack of response by police. This is because today's actions and outcomes are steeped in history. Last June, we made an important announcement by declaring racism a public health crisis. It acknowledged we have 2 crises at the moment, racism and COVID-19. And one of these was with us already. Though I'm proud that at King County, we declared racism a public health crisis, it is also important for us as government to ask some hard questions. Why have we put so much attention, effort, and resources in COVID-19 and we haven't responded to racism with the same level of vigor? Think of the federal government or local funds going to COVID work in the current crisis. Federally, just this month, it was close to $1 trillion, and more has been promised by the incoming president. What role have we as institutions and as individuals played in perpetuating the injustices we have today? And why did it take a dizzying number of stories and images of killing of Black people to get us to this state of declaring racism a public health crisis? We declared racism a public health crisis in June when we were collectively sickened by the images of violence of Black bodies seen on TV and social media on a daily basis. But in addition to these horrific acts of violence, in a more quiet yet no less sinister way, we have lived in a system that is literally killing and suffocating Black and Brown lives every single day through taking away years of life due to chronic disease, burying families in debt due to predatory lending practices and housing policies, and taking away the right to life and health for large portions of a population. When Black and Brown people and families do not have access to the healthy environments and neighborhoods where we can all thrive. We must all recognize that historically and currently, King County as government has been complicit, as well as many other local governments, in maintaining perpetuating structural racism. And as institutions, we must be a vital player in dismantling oppressive systems. I know many at the city of Bellevue are asking these same questions. That's what our declaration means. When we declared racism a public health crisis, we as King County and public health made important commitments around sharing power and resources and working with community on their on community-defined problems using community-driven solutions, co-creating by people most negatively impacted by racism. Also, community leaders and organizations will be provided with resources to co-create We made these commitments because we know that together we can lay the foundation for a better, stronger community. At the end of last year at King County, we produced our anti-racist biennial budget for 2021-2022 and a policy agenda. As part of this budget and policy agenda, we made it clear we are going to transform the way our county views and treats public safety. We must divest from the old system and reinvest in Black, Indigenous, people of color communities who have been most harmed by systems rooted in oppression. Our recent budget and policies include policies and investments to divert both adults and youth from the criminal legal system and to invest in our areas of the county and in communities, health, and human services that are aligned with our racial equity values, in addition to investing in areas of unincorporated King County like Skyway. Our equity has made, our executive has made commitments to close the detention portion of Children and Family Justice Center by 2025. Due to COVID-19 in King County, we were able to decrease the number of adults incarcerated from an average of 1,900 to 1,300, 600 adult reduction in incarceration on a typical day. Now we're committed to continue to decrease these numbers based on our anti-racist principles. As we move into recovery from the pandemic, we cannot make the same mistakes made in 2009's Great Recession that systematically stripped household wealth and by association health from Black and Brown communities. So what's next? As a public health practitioner and for us as a region, a big challenge ahead is vaccination, of course. That's what we're all talking about nowadays. BIPOC communities have been devastated locally by not just the virus, but by the social, economic, and mental health impacts. And I want to point to data once again in a recent national report from Kaiser Family Foundation. To the question, do you feel it is a bad time to be Black in America? We have a we have seen a troubling rise. For Black men, this rose from 2006 from 28% to 2020, 65% saying it's a bad time to be Black in America. For women, this grew from 2011 from 15% to 59%. That's a several fold increase. Part of the same survey asked about experiences in racial discrimination during the past year in different settings. What are those results? For those who experienced discrimination in a store while shopping, it was 8% if you were white, yet 24% if you were Latinx, and 40% if you were Black. In dealing with police, like traffic incidences, it's 5% if you're white, yet 18% if you're Latinx, or 26% if you're Black. While getting healthcare for themselves or family members, 5% of whites and 19% of Latinx and 20% of Blacks. For Black women, and this is critical, who are the primary caretakers often of many families, it was even higher at 25%. And for Black mothers, 37%, just in the last 12 months. The one I just shared and the next one have huge implications in terms of vaccination. For the question of whether healthcare systems often treat people unfairly based on their race or ethnic background, 70% of Blacks answered yes, compared to 43% of Latinx and 41% of whites. Importantly, only 44% of Blacks and 50% of Latinx trust the healthcare system all or most of the time to do what is right for their community. And let's remember Dr. King, who said, of all the forms of inequality, injustice in healthcare is the most shocking and inhumane. So to be successful in King County and nationally, we need to frame the question correctly so we have the right response to the problem. For vaccines and BIPOC communities, we often talk about Black and Indigenous communities having distrust of vaccine or the healthcare system. Ask why, what is the root cause? Racism, things have happened. So this means putting the emphasis on the right problem. Saying trust or mistrust puts blame on the individual, something we must fix in the individual. At the end though, our systems and institutions, including in public health, need to acknowledge past wrongs and work in a different way with communities. Invest in them, listen, have them be part of our institutions and the answers, have them and all of us in positions of power and as spokespeople and break down the ways white dominant organizations and systems have not worked for communities of color. As public health in this next phase, the next months, we have our work cut out for us as we have during the last year, but what's new? At the end though, I am hopeful since I have seen the progress that has happened and how our actions on racial equity are beyond words. And there's been significant progress at the local and national level. Toni Morrison said, "I get angry about things and go on and work, and let's all do the same." Thank you.
Thank you so much, Matias. And I am gonna go ahead and share a slide that Matias shared with us earlier, just in regards to resources. And so you have the information on there where you can find more information with regards to resources. And of course, you know, if you email diversity@bellevuewa.gov, I can pass these along to you as well, so you can get the links for sharing. So now we are going on to the next presenter of today, who's Sandra Early and Wilma von Troy from Collective Innovative Solutions. And they'll be sharing us a little bit more about how to make sure that you recognize the signs of COVID and where to get help if you do have the signs of COVID. So let me go ahead and share that now.
I'm Sandra Early, and I'm the principal at Early Insurance Solutions. Now I'd like to introduce you to Wilma von Troy.
Hello, I am Wilma von Troy. It's a pleasure to be with you. I am a skilled, experienced, and knowledgeable entrepreneur, consultant, and coach, and as well an independent insurance broker who cares deeply about my customers and my community. I am a registered, licensed insurance professional working as a principal with Early Insurance Solutions, and I also provide help for startup businesses with B2B business solutions. I provide individual Medicare and business group plans. Today, we want to spend time drawing your attention to a holistic view of the impacts of this pandemic. We know you are inundated with a lot of information about COVID-19. The information changes daily and minute to minute.
Today, we'd spend some time talking about the social impacts of COVID-19. The pandemic has us anxious, fearful, in social isolation, and in a state of economic uncertainty. To dive a little bit deeper, it created housing instability, food insecurity, social isolation, and financial strain. Just working from home changed everything, particularly since we have our children there. Sometimes, you know, they're studying. Everything has changed. We're in a new world order. The social impacts can exacerbate the existing health conditions. We might find ourselves being short with others, short with our partners, creating some violence, child abuse, and of course, we're very concerned about the medical impacts, care coverage. We have individual responsibilities and community responsibilities as well. And how are we going to meet those challenges? And then there's the issue about the distribution of vaccine. So to circle back on the individual responsibilities, we need to stay vigilant about how we act and who we act with. We need to stay informed. We need to educate ourselves, seek education from others, healthcare providers, and our health plan. We need to pay attention to the changes in our community, the changes in ourselves, and try to figure out how to be resilient. Dr. Fauci provided some rules or simple steps to help keep us and our families safe. Wear a mask when around others. Wash hands for 20 seconds. Get your flu shot. Get plenty of rest. And when necessary, visit your doctor if you're not feeling well.
Some of their responsibilities are to send employees home who have COVID symptoms. Number two, if they are so inclined and if they have been approved, administer COVID-19 testing before employees enter the workplace. That is the old temperature and some questions that may be administered to the employee. Most importantly, the employer must comply with ADA, EEOC, the Rehab Act, and HIPAA regulations, all of which deal with medical information and its dissemination, but also with disabilities and health issues. That includes the pandemic. Require a doctor's release to return to duty is another area that the employer is responsible. Now, for the community, there have been vaccine prioritization responsibilities. CDC leads the charge for prioritization at the federal level. Their prioritizations have been issued long time ago, prior to the FDA approval of our current vaccines. The first tier one level is healthcare workers, which we are well into, and many have been, but not all, have been vaccinated. There also is a second shot, but it has seems to have helped, and particularly has helped our morale in terms of getting ready to beat this that pandemic. The healthcare workers are a population is from 17 to 20 million. The next tier is essential workers, another critical issue and often overlooked as to who and what constitutes essential workers. 60 to 80 million is that population figure. Persons with high-risk medical conditions consuming about 100 million are also the next tier. Older adults are 53 million, the next tier, and younger groups have not yet been addressed, but we hope to have them completed, so they say, by identified and completed by the end of the year. State vaccine prioritization responsibilities are a must. State and local counties are expected to develop their own local prioritization plans. But flash, there have been new changes for Washington to announce. The new changes are effective January the 1st, and they include what they're labeling phase 1B1, that is age 70 persons and older and multi-generational households. These individuals, they hope to have vaccinated by January of this year. Phase 1B2 contains high-risk critical workers 50 plus working in congregate areas. Phase 1B3 is 16 and older with two or more comorbidities. Phase 1B4 is high-risk critical workers in certain congregate settings 50 years and under. Future phases are being developed. Be aware that there are two additional mutations that have already been discovered in England and South Africa, and they're not sure that the current vaccinations will cover those. But keep the faith, we are making changes.
We urge you to get more information from your healthcare provider, from your health plan, and you seek more information from radio, TV, and other healthcare professionals that are in your area. Sandra and Wilma are here to provide additional information. You can reach us by email, also by phone or text. We're going to beat this pandemic. A special thank you to all essential workers, to the City of Bellevue, to the Delta Sigma Theta sorority for inviting us and reserving a place so that we can help celebrate Martin Luther King Jr.
Thank you so much to Sandra and Wilma, who provided us with just really important information with regards to COVID and some of the implementation in the state of Washington of what we are all looking forward to, which is the vaccines. I'll now hand it over to Yuwanda.
Hello, hello. So it is time for more door prizes. So We are going to do a door prize for the Adventures of Little Big Fella. And there will be a PowerPoint put up in just one moment so that you can get more information about them. And so for Little Big Fella, oh, here we go. All right. Their product is children's comic books. And the owner is Shakundi Salisbury. And really just want to ask for you to, as I mentioned with many of the Black businesses we partner with today, to please consider supporting them, even outside of the wonderful door prizes that they have for us. They have been featured with in different areas as well, media features with the South Seattle Emerald and some other places as well. So again, just really thankful for them. Their prize for today are 10 comic book copies, 10 comic book copies. And so our winner is Christopher Radels. Christopher Radels, R-A-D-E-L-S. Again, you will be contacted based on your registration information through Eventbrite. And before I turn it back over to Yuriana, who's going to introduce our next presentation, I did want to add, if you have questions about anything you've seen today, or you want to know how to find out any more information about the various topics, that you could always email diversity@bellevuewa.gov. That was put in the chat a little earlier, but we can put it back in the chat again, just in case you have any questions or need any additional information. So again, thank you to all our partners, and I'll turn it over to Yuriana.
Thank you, Yuanda. I appreciate you sharing these Black-owned businesses. I think, you know, everyone, you know, check them out. They have their websites are provided in the presentation. If you registered for the event today, you will get a copy of the presentation with all their information. They're all doing amazing work. And so thank you so much. We have a short performance from one of our favorites in the MLK event, who we always have every year. And this year, they were able to record themselves before joining, or before the celebration today. And so let's just hear a little bit from what you all might remember, the Sony Byers Band, an amazing jazz group who is here in our close community. So let me see if this video will play. Thank you.
That was a wonderful rendition from the Sunny Byers Band. We're so grateful for them for the video to just get us some more great entertainment. We've had so much creativity and ingenuity and entertainment today that has been just wonderful. So before we move to our next set of speakers, we actually have two more door prizes to give away. So the first one is for Brittany K. Thomas, and her business is branding and graphic design. Her contact information is there on the screen. And again, we just really appreciate the partnership with yet another Black-owned business. And the prize that we have is one 11 by 14 print. And our winner for the Brittany Thomas print is Gabrielle Johnson. Gabrielle Johnson. And again, we will contact you through your information that you put on Eventbrite for registration. And then we have one other door prize to give away right now. And that is for Come Eat Daddy. And this is a catering business owned by Ashante Sims, and her contact information is there. Again, very grateful for her partnership today. And the door prize is one seafood broil. And the winner for Come Eat Daddy is DeAndre D. DeAndre D. So again, congratulations to all of our winners today. We have more door prizes, so don't go anywhere. And so now we are going to move into our with our next speaker. And this is with the Greater Seattle Alcoholics Anonymous, or Greater Seattle AA. And we will be hearing from David D, who is the public information and cooperation with professional communities. He's a part of that particular group with Seattle AA, and we welcome him now to talk with us about that organization. David.
Thank you, Wanda. It's a privilege to be here. I'm grateful for the opportunity on behalf of the Public Information and Cooperation with Professional Communities Committee of Alcoholics Anonymous. I have with me some friends of mine, some fellow members of AA. They are Tim D and also Cynthia, and they will be speaking shortly. So thank you, Tim and Cynthia, for joining us today as well. Like all of Alcoholics Anonymous, our primary purpose is just to carry the message of recovery for the alcoholic that still suffers. Our personal anonymity is important to us, and we try to focus on attraction to the fellowship of AA as a whole rather than the promotion of ourselves as individuals. As non-professionals, we don't have an opinion on other forms of recovery. We welcome our partners in the recovery field, but we don't express an opinion or demonstrate any knowledge in that area other than for Alcoholics Anonymous. And the only requirement for AA is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees associated with being an AA member. So with that, I'm going to get quickly into my own story. I started drinking when I was 13 years old. I started drinking at a kegger, they used to call them, in a park. And I went up there and I had my first drink, and I felt instantly better because I was always a little uncomfortable in my own skin. And so I tried that, and I drank too much, and it just got progressively worse after that over a period of 13 years, until by the time I was 26, I had alienated my family. I had lost jobs. I had ended up in situations of being homeless and stuff like that. And I was lucky. My family came to do an intervention on me and took me to a treatment center. And at that treatment center, some folks like Tim and Cynthia were kind enough to bring an AA meeting into the treatment center, and that's where I learned about Alcoholics Anonymous. And so I was able to follow a few simple suggestions, and now I have a wonderful life. This month I'm celebrating 32 years of sobriety. I have a wonderful wife and two kids and friends and a job where I get to help people, and I also have the opportunity to contribute back to the community in ways such as we're doing today on Martin Luther King Day. So I'm very grateful to Alcoholics Anonymous, and I'm happy to help make the connection for anyone that is interested in finding out more about it. And with that, I'll turn it over to Cynthia, who is going to be our next speaker. Thank you, Cynthia.
Hi, everyone. My name is Cynthia. I'm a grateful alcoholic. I've been sober for 21 years. At the end of my drinking, I just could not control when I started drinking. I couldn't control how much I was going to drink. I would make sweet promises to my kids and my parents, you know, that I would get it together. But once I started drinking, I just couldn't stop. And when things got really, really bad, I mean, when things were falling apart, I just couldn't stop at all. I became so scared. I felt alone even when I was with other people. And I felt hopeless. I thought that there was just no way out of how I was living. What happened for me was that as I began drinking around that time, I started thinking about suicide. And that really scared me. So one day I called the 24-hour drug and alcohol hotline. And they told me about AA. And, my first thought was, then people can't help me. And then I said, well, yeah, I know ain't nobody that looked like me up in AA, because I sure don't know nobody. Mm-hmm. But I was so desperate that I went anyway. And it changed my life. My relationships with my children and my parents were restored. The joy of living and serenity inside, is just priceless, and I've got a host of friends. I try to help other women, my life is just better. When I got the email for the link to speak, at the bottom of the email, it said, something like Bellevue welcomes the world, and it said our diversity is our strength. And it had me, I rested on that, because in Alcoholics Anonymous, in my opinion, because I don't speak for AA as a whole, but in my experience, our strength is in our unity. One alcoholic helping another, one alcoholic being willing to reach their hand into the trenches to help another alcoholic get sober. And with it being a MLK event, I thought about some of the early Blacks that got sober in Alcoholics Anonymous. And I'm about running out of my time, but one that I thought about his name was Joe McHugh. And he was the first Black to get sober in Arkansas. And he desperately wanted to get sober. And the group got together and they knew that this disease was killing people, alcoholism. And they also knew that they had found a solution. And despite all of the, racial segregation and all of that going on at that time, they did not want this Black man to die. So what they did is they told him that he could come to the meeting. He could not come early. He could not stay after the meeting, and he couldn't drink their coffee. But they told him that we will help you to get sober. The guy, Joe, ended up hooking up with another guy named Charlie. And they ended up going across the country and in other international states, kind of carrying this message of hope. Joe became one of the first Blacks to speak at the AA International Conference in 1985. So, you know, the door, you know, I'm thankful for the early Blacks that came to AA that opened the door to carry the message and to bring the diversity and the unity that many years later, you know, with the hand was extended to me to get sober. So on this Martin Luther King Day, I just wanted to also share about some of the early Blacks in Alcoholics Anonymous. And with that, I want to thank you for your time. And if you think you may have a drinking problem, the website and the phone number, I think, has been placed in the chat. But there is a way out. And thank you. And I'm going to pass it over to Tim.
Hi, thanks, everyone. I'm Tim. I'm an alcoholic. Just real simple. I was once very lost for about maybe 15 years, but by the grace of God and the program of Alcoholics Anonymous and folks like David and Cynthia, today I'm found in March, it will be 12 years. And for that, I am grateful that I'm free. I'm free at last. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tim. And Cynthia, I appreciate you guys speaking very powerful messages there. And I appreciate the Delta Sigma Theta sorority and the city of Bellevue and Uriana for giving us this opportunity to carry the message. And as you see, hopefully you see in the chat, the phone number and the website are there. As Cynthia mentioned, 206-587-2838. Is the phone number, that's 24/7. And we have virtual meetings and we're happy to be of service in any way that we can. Thank you.
Thank you so much to Seattle Alcoholics Anonymous and David, Cynthia, and Tim. There's nothing like hearing someone's story to feel empowered and to know that alcoholism is something that can be overcome and that you can be free and that there is a community out there to support. And so just thank you so much for being willing to share your personal stories. We really do appreciate it. And now we are going to move to two more door prizes before we move to our very last demonstration for today. And so our first is for Fei Wu Signature Collection. This is fashion design. And the contact, or actually the owner, is Sonia Wooten Gill. And you see the information there, the contact information. The business has also been featured on New Day Northwest, Evening Magazine. And again, we're very grateful for the partnership of this Black-owned business who is donating two face masks as a prize for today. And so our winner for these two face masks is Gazelle Tan, G-A-Z-E-L Tan. Has won the two face masks. Congratulations. And again, you will be contacted with your registration information. And now we have our next Black-owned business that we're going to highlight. And this is So Nice Designs. And their product is homemade soaps, body butters, dolls, masks, and much more. The owner is Jackie Scott. Again, very grateful for the donation of this door prize here today and for partnership with all of these Black-owned businesses. And this business has been highlighted at Nordstrom, Seattle Times, the Oakland Arts Paper, and it's a door prize of one bar of soap and one jar of body butter. And so our winner for So Nice Designs is Gerald Lofton. So again, we will contact you based on your registration information in Eventbrite. So now we are going to move on to our last presentation of the day. And this is Baking at Home with Kathy Jo Miller Taylor. And this is a video. This is going to be a lot of fun. So, you know, we talked earlier and actually throughout the day about how important it is to have a balance and to be mindful and mental health. And so when you think about often being stuck at home with COVID, cooking is one way to release and do something different and use creativity and use your hand. And so this is actually a baking demonstration video. Some background on Kathy, she was exposed to entrepreneurship when she worked one summer in her uncle's moving business. That, compared to her love of her mom and her grandma's baking, she wanted to open her own old-fashioned sweet shop that families could enjoy. So she now owns KJ's, and KJ's is Central Avenue in Kent, Washington. Again, please consider supporting all of our Black-owned businesses. And now we will have the video where she will be showing us how to cook something fun in the kitchen.
Hi, I'm Kathy Jo, and I own KJ's Cakery Bakery Sweet Shop in Kent, Washington. Today, we're going to show you how to make hot cocoa bombs. So let's get started. So to make your hot cocoa bombs, you will need a spatula, a tablespoon, a measuring cup. You need a cup or two of chocolate wafers, and you can get these at any of your grocery stores, Joann's or Michael's. You will need a couple packets of hot cocoa mix. You will also need some mini marshmallows. You will need a plate that you will heat up in the microwave, and you will also need a silicone mold. So the first thing we're going to do, we're going to take our measuring cup. We're going to place our chocolate wafers in our cup. Sometimes chocolate will need a little bit of oil to thin out the chocolate. And so you're going to go ahead and pour maybe a couple tablespoons of the oil on top of your chocolate. We're going to heat up the chocolate in 30-second intervals in the microwave. Usually it takes about a minute to melt about a cup of chocolate. So I have already melted some chocolate for you, and it's here. So the next thing we're going to do is take our tablespoon and fill each one of our six cavities with chocolate. So we take our tablespoon, you pour it in, and then what you want to do is take the chocolate and make sure that you are filling the entire cavity with the back of the tablespoon. So we're going to do this for all six of ours. Typically, I will just go ahead and pour my six. I will fill each of my cavities first. Now that we have filled our six cavities, we would place the silicone in the refrigerator for about 15 minutes. I'm going to set this one aside, and I have one of the molds that has been in the refrigerator for about 15 minutes. So the next step is we have to do this a second time, because if we don't, the edges of our mold will be too thin and we won't be able to form our circle. So we'll take our chocolate a second time, and we don't need quite as much chocolate because the goal here is really to fill the edge, the upper edge of the cavity. So we have placed our silicone mold in the refrigerator twice. This is the second time with the second coating. So what we're going to do now is remove our chocolate from the silicone. And we do that by turning the silicone mold over. You can hold the top of the silicone here and just gently pull back. And what you have is a beautiful, shiny mold. So we're going to remove all of these from the cavity. Now, the next thing that we need to do, each of the edges, as you can see, they're kind of jagged. So what we're going to do is take our hot plate. So you would have taken this plate, placed it in the microwave for probably a minute to get it warm enough. You're going to gently put the chocolate on top, and you're going to swirl it around. And when you remove it, you'll see that your edges are very smooth. So we're going to do that for all six of our molds. Okay, so I have smoothed out all the edges of my chocolate cavities. And what we're going to do now, we're going to bring our plate back and we're going to start filling our cavities. So I'll move this over here so you can see it better. So we're going to take a little bit of our chocolate and place it inside each of our cavities. And this is just regular hot chocolate that you can buy in any grocery store. And I'm placing about a half of a bag in each of the cavities. The next thing you're going to do is you're going to fill your cavity with marshmallows. Now you can fill your cavities with sugar, you can fill your chocolate with peppermint. Oh, spilled a little bit there. I'm just gonna use my hands. You can fill it with anything you like. My classic hot cocoa bombs are just filled with chocolate and marshmallows. So once you get your cavities filled, the next thing we're going to do, and that one needs a little bit more, we're going to take the top of our chocolate. We're going to heat it up again. And the reason we're doing this is that we need a way to seal our mold. So we're going to take our mold. We're going to line it up with the bottom one. And we're going to gently press it together. And you see it is completely sealed. It's wet right now, but it'll take maybe 5 minutes and this will completely dry. You can then take your hot cocoa bomb and you can place it in a cupcake liner. You can drizzle it with chocolate. You can put other toppings on it. How do you drink your hot chocolate bomb? So what you're going to do once your hot cocoa bomb is completely dry, you would take it, and we're going to see if we can do this, and you're going to place it in your cup like so. Next, what we're going to do is pour your favorite milk on top of your hot cocoa bomb. That could be almond milk, it could be oat milk, it could be coconut milk, or just regular milk. So we're going to pour our milk on top of the whole hot cocoa bomb until it explodes. And my milk is pretty warm, and there it goes. So all of your hot chocolate and all of your marshmallows that floated to the top, you can give it a stir to continue to help melt the chocolate. And that's how you make hot cocoa bombs. Thank you for joining me. Have a good day.
So I am so hungry right now because that looks so awesome. I'm sitting here thinking about how I can get that made because that looks wonderful. And we are actually moving on to our last prize of the day, where some lucky winner won't have to make their chocolate bomb because the prize is actually a chocolate bomb, a do-it-yourself cocoa bomb kit from KJ's Bakery. And I'll just wait so we get the get all of her information up so you'll know more about her bakery. But that is the prize. So you just met Kathy Jo Miller Taylor. We're so grateful for her partnering with us and making us all super hungry at the end of the day today with that chocolate bomb walkthrough. She has been featured at Seattle Tourism, Seattle's Child, KRIZ, Seattle Medium, several different places. And the door prize is a cocoa bomb kit. And so our winner from KJ's Bakery is Jim Rawley. Jim Rawley, R-A-W-L-E-Y. And so again, we will contact you via your registration information from Eventbrite. And for any of you that won a prize today, if you did not register through Eventbrite, we'll put the link in the chat one last time to make sure you go in and register so that we have your information. And so now we are nearing the end of our time with you. And so I'm just going to say a few words before I pass it over to Yuriana to introduce our last performance and close us out for today. So as president of the Bellevue Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, I first want to start by just expressing our sincere gratitude to the city of Bellevue. We are so blessed to have this partnership with you over the years and so grateful for all of the of the passion that you all have around this particular event and the celebration of a very, very important day, which is more than just about one day. It's about the entire Black experience, as we have heard so many different times today. And so we're truly, truly grateful. Also for all of the panelists, thank you so much for donating your time and contributing to the success of this day. And then also for all of the participants, we're so grateful for you celebrating with us today. With this being our first all virtual event, it has just been a fantastic time. And we did run a little bit late, and we're thank you for all of you that stuck it out with us. So many just great presentations and performances for us to really share with you. It was hard for us to keep it on time, but we're thankful that you stayed here with us. And again, happy Martin Luther King Jr. Day to you all. And so I'm going to end with just a quote before I turn it over to Yuriana from one of Martin Luther King's many quotes. And this one is, if you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward. Again, thank you so much. It's been a wonderful, wonderful event. And I will pass it back over to Yuriana.
Thank you so much, Yuwanda. And again, thank you for all who are still with us today. We have a very, very special closing, which we will end our program with, just as it resonates with the message that we have had today around Dr. King and building healthy, thriving communities. This has really been an honor to have spent this space today with you all. I hope that there's a lot of reflection, but there's also a lot of self-love and love for our communities. And so with that said, our closing performance is one that we all appreciate and admire so much. And we've had the honor of having the Ross Band with us previously in person. And Ross McCommon has a beautiful rendition of a few songs, which we will leave out today with. And I hope the rest of the evening is great for you all. Please stick around as we showcase our last performer. Thank you, Ross. And thank you to those that accompany her today.
We shall overcome.
We shall overcome.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Deep in my heart, I do believe we shall overcome. Oh, someday we shall live in peace. We shall live. We're gonna live in peace. In peace.
time is filled with swift transitions. Not a verb unmoved can stand. Oh, yeah. Oh, build your hope on things eternal, on things eternal. And hold on to God's unchanging hands. Sing along with me out there. Come on and hold to his hands. God's unchanging hands. Hold to his hands.
God's unchanging hands.
Oh, why don't you build your home on things eternal. Trust in him who will not leave you. No. And whatsoever years may bring, oh yeah. Oh, and if your earthly friends, they will forsake you. But still more closely to him cling. Oh, everybody ought to hold to his hands, God's unchanging hand.
Hoping for love, for your love.
word to say.
That's why I believe that praying's what we need for bringing us together so we can pray.
Can you hear my cry? There's so much hurt going on. There's so much, too much hurt all around. Every day we praise you.
This is a great celebration. We thank you all for joining us, listening to us. We look forward to a great year and to have more people like Dr. King. No, it doesn't make much sense. There ought to be a lot against anyone who takes offense at a day in your celebration. God, we all know in our minds that there ought to be a time that we can set aside just to show just how much we love you. And I'm sure you would agree, couldn't fit more perfectly than a hello world party on the day you came to be. Happy birthday to happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday. I never understood just how a man who died for good could not have a day that would be set aside for his recognition. Cause it should never be just because some cannot see all the dream that came to be. Shouldn't make it become an illusion. And we all know everything that his silver tongue will bring. War and peace our hearts will sing, thanks to Martin Luther King. Happy birthday to happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday. Why has there never been a holiday where peace is celebrated? We know that love can win. Let out a hold in, loud as it can. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday. Happy birthday birthday.
Thank you, everyone. This concludes our program. We hope you have a beautiful day, and we'll see you next year.